Hey everybody, I'm Chase, the online pastor here, and I want to welcome you to our Christmas services at Oak Ridge Online. Listen, we're so glad that you're here and we're so excited to celebrate Christmas with you right now. Hey, and wherever you are, no matter if you follow Jesus or not, I believe that He personally has you, yes, you, here for a reason right now. Listen, it's no secret that 2020 has been hard on all of us, and if you're like me, you might be feeling a little hopeless or down at the end of this year. But hey, as we go into our Christmas Eve service today, I want you to be thinking about something. What if there was a hope that was bigger than COVID? Bigger than our circumstances? What if there was a light that banished the darkness and made a way for you to have true hope and healing? I believe that in today's service, that question is going to be answered. We have an amazing service planned for you, and I cannot wait to experience it together. And that all starts right now.
Hark how the bells, sweet silver bells, all seem to say, throw cares away. Christmas is here, bringing good cheer to young and old, meek and the bold.
Ding dong, ding dong,
ding dongy dong, that is their song, with joyful ring, all caroling.
One seeks to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air.
Oh, how they pound, raising the sound, o'er hill and dale, telling their tale,
gaily they ring,
while people sing songs of good cheer.
Christmas is here.
Merry, 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 merry Christmas. Merry, 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 merry Christmas. On, on they send, on without end, their joyful tone to every home. Hark how the bells, sweet silver bells, all seem to say, throw cares away. Ding dongy dong, that is their song, with joyful ring, all caroling.
One seems to hear words of good cheer from everywhere, filling the air.
Oh, how they pound, raising the sound, o'er hill and dale,
telling their tale, gaily they ring, while people sing songs of good cheer.
Christmas is here. Merry, 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 merry Christmas. Merry, 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 merry Christmas. Merry, 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 merry Christmas. Merry, 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 merry Christmas.
Thank you. Well, that's how you open up a Christmas service. Let me welcome you guys for joining us tonight. Thank you for spending some of your Christmas with us. Let me give a shout out to everybody who's in our other venues and our theater, the watch party, and for everybody who's watching online. We are honored that you would spend your Christmas with us. We've got a great service planned for you tonight. And if this is your first time with us or you're back for a second visit, let me tell you that you are not only welcome, but you are wanted here at Oak Ridge, and we are glad that you are here. Well, we've got a great service planned for you tonight. We're going to sing some more worship songs in just a minute, and then Pastor Brian Moss, our lead pastor, will be out in just a minute with a message just for you that's going to be full of hope. And I don't know about you, but with everything else that's going on right now, I think we need a little bit of hope right now, don't we? Well, it's going to be a great message. And then later in the service, we're going to do something that we normally do, a traditional candlelight service. But if you know, nothing about this year has been traditional. So we're going to ask you to pull your phones out during our candlelight service. And we're actually going to turn the flashlights on to our phone so that we can all join in together. Whether you're in one of our venues or online, we can do this all together as a church. And I think it's going to be so cool to do that. Well, listen, after you get your set... Well, you could talk. If I could talk right now, that would be good. This is why you don't need a lot of cookies before you come on stage, okay? Hey, to get the most out of tonight's message with Pastor Brian, if you would just follow along with his message notes and also fill out your Connect card that you got when you came in. Let me know what you thought about your experience, how the guy on stage doesn't talk very good. And just give me some feedback on what you thought about the service. We design these services with you in mind, and we would just love to hear some feedback with you from you. You can use the message note card and connect card that you got when you came in, or you can text the word connect card to 484848. We'll send that bad boy right to your phone if you'd like to go digital or if you're watching online. Well, we're going to get back into worship, but before we do, let me take a moment and pray for our time together. Father, thank you. Thank you for allowing us to come together, Lord, with all of our imperfections, with all of our things, Lord, even when we can't talk right, Lord, but you love us anyway. No matter what's going on, no matter what we do, you love us. And I pray that we'd be reminded of that tonight. And for those that came in here tonight, maybe aren't sure of that, Lord, or questioning that, or just feeling hopeless, I pray that you give them some hope tonight. And Father, that you'd let them know, maybe even for the first time, how much you love them through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, be with us as we continue this Christmas service. In Jesus' name, amen.
Food. So much for singing with us. You can have a seat now.
Let your heart be thine. faithful friends who are dear to us, gather near to us once more. Through the years, we all will be together. If the fates
way. Hey, Merry Christmas, everyone. I'm so glad you guys are joining us here today. I want to welcome those who are both here in the live as well as over in the theater and the Ridge and everyone who's joining us online. I'm so glad that you are here. This is our final Christmas service, and I hope that you have had a great time so far. Hey, without a doubt, would you agree with me? This has been the craziest year I've ever lived through. How many of you would say, man, this has been one crazy year? In fact, it's so crazy, it's been too weird for words, and so I thought I'd sum it up in some memes at the end of the year, okay? How about this? Tired of those kids being all cooped up in the house all year? Well, take them outside for some playtime with the 2020 swing. I don't know if you've seen this baby, but if you have trouble getting the kids down for a nap, this will do the job. If the swing gets too boring for you, head over to the 2020 slide. Shkaboom. Don't believe in spanking? That'll do the trick, all right? Now, if you prefer indoor games instead, how about the 2020 arcade? This has been a real hit. Boom, boom, ah. This one will take you, Merry Christmas. Okay. Well, however your year has been, we're glad that you're here. You probably started off this morning with a cup of coffee in your favorite 2020 mug. You got this. You got this. And then afterwards, you grabbed a bowl of some 2020 cereal. Pretty sure I ate some of that in the 70s. Hopefully, when you pulled in, you found a great parking spot in your 2020 ride. By the way, parking team said your right headlight is still on. And then as you approached the building, you were greeted, hopefully warmly greeted, by our 2020 greeter team. But no worries, before you got here, we knew you were coming, so we set out a very special 2020 fragrance made just for you. I think they call this one Eau de Toilette. Well, before you got here, though, we stocked all the bathrooms. Most importantly, with that hardest to come by commodity, we stocked up with the special 2020 toilet paper. This, ouch. Well, the truth is, for most of us, we probably started out in 2020 this past January feeling like this guy, we could conquer the world, man. Bring it. But by the time we hit December, many of us were feeling more like this guy. You know, it's like, ooh, I didn't see that one coming. Get it? Why do we laugh at something like a global pandemic? Here's the truth. It's because humor is the heart's way of making light of something that, in fact, is very dark. It's because of how hard it is for us to process the tragedy, the difficulties, the problems of this year. Psychologists call it distancing. It's your brain's way of trying to neutralize the impact, to soften the blow, because, would you agree, an awful lot has come at all of us this year. And our mind knows that there's actually a tipping point by which our entire world could come crumbling in, that our hope can be crushed. Proverbs 13 says it this way: when hope is crushed, the heart follows suit. When our hope becomes crushed, your heart can just give up. And 2020 has been that kind of year for many of us. So what is it that causes our hope to get crushed? Let me mention three things specifically that you might have faced some this year. Maybe even you came to this service with one of these. Here's the first one. Maybe you came with unsolvable problems. Unsolvable problems can crush your hope. When you feel as though there's just no way out and there's no way to fix what you're facing. POWs during World War II held by the German forces were forced to work in some of the factories to produce the very munitions that the Germans were using to fight the war. In one particular concentration camp where they were working, a factory was actually bombed out by the Allies, so the Germans were unsure what to do with them. So they took the POWs and they gave every one of them a shovel. And they took them out into a field and they ordered them to dig a hole, and they dug for 8 to 10 hours that day until there was a huge, tremendous hole. Then they marched them back into the barracks And the very next morning when they got them up, they ordered them to fill that hole that they had dug. And the exact same process carried on day after day after day. Digging the hole and filling the hole. And digging the hole and filling the hole. So much so that some of the prisoners began to just go out of their mind. In fact, they set down their shovel. They walked away from the guards that were ordering them to return. And they preferred to take a bullet in the head than to continue to do something that they knew they couldn't fix. And the truth is, some of you, you know exactly what that's like. That you don't know how to fix the problems in your life. And when you reach that point, hope can get crushed. David wrote this and said, "Lord, come and show me your mercy, for I'm helpless, I'm overwhelmed, I'm in deep distress, and it feels like my problems are going from bad to worse." Now, maybe some of you, you feel that way this Christmas, that your problems just keep mounting and your life seems to be filled with these unsolvable problems, and that can crush your hope. Or maybe for you, it's unending pressure. Stress is destroying the hope inside of you. I don't know if you've seen one of these babies, but it seems like these got real popular recently. You know, we like to call them Instapots, right? And the truth is, they've been around for quite a while. It's nothing more than just a pressure cooker. And actually, the way these things work is pretty simplistic. It operates on three principles. First, the heat keeps rising. Second, the vapors get trapped. And third, because of the pressure, it just squeezes in and cooks what's inside. Some of you know exactly how that feels. You'd say, "Pastor Ryan, that pretty much describes my world. Unending heat, intensity of pressure, and I feel trapped, and the stress is killing you." Anybody feeling that way this year? Well, Paul, the apostle in the Bible, he shared with some of his friends in the city of Corinth and wrote them this letter, and he said, "We don't want you to be uninformed about the trouble we experienced. In fact, we were under great pressure, so bad it was beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired even of life itself." That kind of describes the way 2020 has been for many people. You know, recently a Gallup poll showed the sharpest decline in 9 months for mental health among Americans. 17 percentage points dropped. And BOC just ran a story last week reporting that 2020 is going to go down as the worst year ever on record for the number of overdoses. People don't know how to deal with these unsolvable problems and unending pressure. But for you, it might be the third choice. It might be, for you, unbearable pain. Many Americans are feeling that. Some of you are dealing with the pain of the past. You know, Christmas is that season of nostalgia. We things come up from our childhood, and we often think and associate that with just the positive. But the truth is, for some of us, it's not positive. And Christmas memories don't bring up pleasant thoughts. It actually brings up painful memories. Or maybe for you, that pain is dealing with a painful relationship in your life right now. Or maybe for you, like so many others, it's the pain of loss. You know, we keep hearing on the news over and over and over again the death count from COVID, over 300,000 people who have died this year. But the truth is, add to that, 650,000 people will have died this year due to heart disease. Over 600,000 will die this year from cancer. You just throw in the accidents, overdose, suicide, and all the other diseases, and nearly 3 million Americans will be absent this Christmas. And maybe for you, you might be dealing with the pain of loss. And for you, it's the pain of an empty chair. Someone who won't be there this year. You know, even in our own church family, one of the greeters that was signed up to greet you tonight as you entered this building was a man by the name of Bill Massey. You might have known him if you've ever been to our church before, because he was one of the most faithful greeters we've ever had. He was at every Santa's Wonderland and every Christmas service for the last 15 years. He didn't miss a single one. He was immobile, handicapped in a wheelchair. And as we started our very first of the Christmas services this year, Bill Massey was found dead in his home. And even in our own worship team, we've had incredible loss this year. And some of you, that's exactly what's happening in your heart this Christmas. It's the pain of loss. And for some of us, even when it's not recent, maybe it's been many years. For me, it's my parents that have been gone for 12 years. This will mark the 12th Christmas. And you say, well, after 12 years, surely it's over. But the truth is, these people touched our hearts and our lives and left a hole. You know, we read in the Bible, these people in the Bible, and we think of them as almost superhuman, like they were, you know, so godly that they weren't touched by the things that touch our lives. But yet David, who was identified as one of the greatest men of God, writes in his diary, and he said this: my heart is filled with pain. You say, well, Pastor Brian, this is kind of a depressing Christmas message. I thought Christmas was just full of joy. But listen, believe it or not, these are exactly the conditions and the circumstances that existed 2,020 years ago on the very first Christmas. Unsolvable problems, unending pressure, unbearable pain, so much so that it caused God's people to look into the heavens and to cry out, God, when will you fix the problems that we face? Lord, won't you come?
The people who have walked in darkness have seen a great light. For those who lived in a land of deep shadows, light. The joy of a great celebration, sharing rich gifts and warm greetings. For a child has been born for us, the gift of a son, for you and for me. And his name will be Amazing Counselor, Strong God, Eternal Father, and Prince of Peace. And there will be no limits to the wholeness that he brings.
Oh,
So what needs hope in your life this Christmas? Maybe for you, it's I need some hope inside of my marriage, or maybe it's a relationship. Maybe there's a hurting in your heart for a child. Maybe for you, you need some hope in your finances, and you're like, man, I don't know how we're going to make it. Maybe you need some hope in a health situation. You know, the truth is, all we talk about is COVID, but the fact of the matter is that a lot of other health issues still exist, and people are struggling with them. Maybe for you, there's a cycle of addiction that you just can't seem to break. Maybe you need some hope inside of your family, or maybe even in your future, and you wonder what 2021 is really going to bring, and you're hoping it's going to be better. Well, believe it or not, 2020 is the perfect setting to understand the way in which Christmas brought hope into the world that very first Christmas. You see, hope is not just wishful wanting. Hope is not about positive platitudes or a desperate desire. According to the Bible, hope is concrete, and it has three specific components, and each of them matter for bringing hope. Here's the first one. The Bible says that hope is a promise. That hope is a promise. I hope you've had some time to watch some of your favorite Christmas movies this season. I know Lisa and I have had some time to be able to watch some of those movies. And in fact, I just wonder, online audience, type in there in the chat and let me know, what is your favorite Christmas movie? Your all-time favorite Christmas movie. Well, for me, it's A Wonderful Life. I'm a sucker for that movie. I absolutely love this movie. And one of the reasons I love it is because it's a powerful story of how one life can touch so many other lives. It's a story of George Bailey. And I love the scene in the movie where his whole world just crashes in. And he reaches a point of desperation, and he does, in fact, what so many of us do instinctively. When we come to the end of our world, we instinctively know that hope comes from heaven. Hope is not something that I can manufacture or bring about. And the biggest problems that I have in my life, I can't actually even fix. Hope has to come from heaven. You say, well, Pastor Brian, Christmas this year seems kind of a contrast to the chaos of a 2020. I mean, if you think about it, COVID, a global pandemic, riots across the country, political division and hatred and angst and animosity like we've never seen, sickness and death all around us, it leaves you asking why. Why is there so much suffering and sickness and sorrow in this world? Why is there so much pain and problem and pressure in this world? Well, the Bible says that the pain and the problems that we experience come from a decision that happened in the garden thousands and thousands of years ago. It comes from a principle called sin. You see, I want you to know, our problems didn't come from China. They didn't come from politicians. They didn't even come from the White House. The truth is, our problems stem from our own house, or more specifically, from our own hearts. You see, the Bible says when we rebelled against God in the garden, we told God to shove off. We don't want to live the way that He's called us to live. And even in that moment, thousands of years ago, from the first time that we rejected God, at that moment, God made a choice. He chose, because of His infinite mercy, His limitless love, in the garden, He made a promise. And that promise was to fix the problem. Listen, He didn't cause the problem, but He made a commitment to cure the problem. And that cure, He said, would come in the form of a Savior, the Messiah, God's one and only Son. And so for thousands of years, God's people waited and they hoped and they prayed for that Messiah. And over the years, God would send signposts to the Savior. Literally hundreds of prophecies giving unmistakable details about the life of the one who was coming to fix it all so that we couldn't possibly miss the Messiah. In fact, let me give you an example of just one written over 700 years before Jesus was born. It's in a little bitty book, the book of Micah. It's tucked away in the Old Testament, but God gave us a signpost, and it said this: "You, O Bethlehem, you're only a small village among all the people of Judah, and yet a ruler of Israel, whose origins are in the distant past, will come from you on my behalf. And the people of Israel will be abandoned to their enemies until the woman in labor gives birth. And she'll give birth to a son, and he will stand to lead his flock with the Lord's strength and in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And he will be highly honored around the whole world. And he, in fact, will become the source of all peace." There's something about a baby being born in a little insignificant town called Bethlehem that would transform this world. And listen, for some of you, the missing piece in your life is that you're missing peace. That you don't have the peace that God... Now, we know Christmas is about peace because in the Christmas story, remember, the angels came into the heaven and they shouted out, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace and goodwill to all men." Now, in 2020, you could rightfully say, "Oh, really? Where is this peace that was promised from heaven?" Well, I've discovered that true peace is not governed by what's going on around me. True peace is about the life that God is living in me. Christmas was the promise of God's peace. And dear friend, there is an anchor and a peace that will anchor your soul in the midst of suffering, sickness, and pain that will never let go. Hope is the promise of God's peace. Here's the second thing the Bible says: hope is a person. It's not just a promise, it's a person. During every war, mothers will often try to keep the memory of the father fresh in the mind of the children. And during World War II, one young mom decided that every day she would take her young son into the living room where there was a large portrait of his father on the wall. And she would have him look at the portrait and share stories of what his dad was really like. And one day, the boy grabs her arm, pulls her down, and says, "Mommy, wouldn't it be great if Dad could step out of the portrait and right here where we're living?" Dear friend, that's exactly what Christmas is all about. That God stepped out of heaven right where we're living. And Christmas is the promise that became a person. We read in the story of Matthew's biography of Jesus that Mary was engaged when she became pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Now, her fiancé, Joseph, he loved her, but he was kind of like, "Oh, let me get this straight. You're pregnant, but it was by God." Okay, I get it, right? So he's kind of struggling with this idea, and he doesn't know what to do. And so the Bible picks up and says this: as Joseph considered breaking the engagement, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. "Joseph, son of David," the angel said, "do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sin." Now, it might not seem obvious, but why does naming him Jesus mean that he saves people from sin? What is that all about? Well, Jesus is actually the Greek form of the Old Testament Hebrew name Yeshua, which literally means God saves. So you can't say the name Jesus without acknowledging that he is a Savior. It goes on: all of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. "Behold, the virgin will conceive a child, and she will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which literally means "our God is with us." You know, it's crazy, but the cure would come from a cradle. You know, we've talked a lot about the COVID vaccine. The stories continually talk about how now we are getting restored hope. Well, can I just be honest with you? The COVID vaccine might keep you from getting COVID. It will not save you from the grave. The fact is, what we need is a vaccine that can save beyond the grave. And that is exactly why God sent his only son, Jesus Christ. Christmas is when heaven became human, when God stepped into the mix of our humanity and provided a pathway so that you and I could have eternal life. You see, Jesus wasn't born for a manger. He was born for the cross. He came to die the death that we deserve so that he could offer the life none of us could ever earn. You know the verse, John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son so that whoever believes in him shall not perish but shall have eternal life. God's priceless gift to you wasn't placed under a tree. He was placed upon a tree where he bled and he died to give his life so that he could offer you his grace. When God stepped out of heaven, he didn't put on a red suit and say, ho, ho, ho. He put on a flesh suit, stained it red with his own blood, and offered his salvation. The vaccine came from his own veins. And that vaccine will cure us from the problem of sin and cleanse us and make us whole again, because hope is a promise, hope is a person, and third, hope is a power. Hope is a power. The Christmas story goes on and says this. This is how Jesus, the Messiah, was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant, notice, through the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, we all have probably heard this before, and we know about the virgin birth and that it was a miracle, but I want you to understand, we may not understand that the power that transformed Mary from a lowly Hebrew Jewish girl, an ordinary girl, and transformed her to become the mother of the Savior of all mankind, that same power is still changing lives today. He's called the Holy Spirit. And I've got good news for you. God still does miracles in people's lives. The same power that transformed Mary can transform your problem, your pressure, and your pain into his peace. But it can only be done through his power. That's why Paul wrote in Romans 15, he said, I pray that God, who is in fact the source of hope, that he will fill you completely with joy and peace. How? How does that happen? Because you trust in him. Then you will overflow with confident hope. How? Through the power of the Holy Spirit. I don't think it's a mistake that the exact same phrase is used here to say that you, dear friend, can experience the hope of Christmas. So how do you do that? How does that work? Well, like any other gift that you're going to receive this Christmas, it has to be opened to do you any good. So today, I want to give you an opportunity to receive the gift that only God can give you, the transformation power of the Holy Spirit to give you his hope. So would you bow your heads and close your eyes for just a moment as I lead us in a prayer? And if you've never done that, if you've never received the power that God can give you through Jesus Christ, would you just simply pray this prayer with me right now? Not to me, but with me in your heart. God sees into your heart. Just say to him, God, thank you for sending Jesus. Lord, if I'm going to be very, very honest, there's a hole in my heart, and I don't have the peace that I need. The truth is, I need a fresh start and a brand new heart, God, and I know that only you can do that. So thank you, Jesus, that you came to this earth, that you died on the cross, and that you rose from the dead for me. Lord, today I want to give you a gift. Actually, the only gift you ever really wanted, I give you me. Not just a part of me, but all of me. Not just a prayer here and there when I'm in trouble, but from this day forward, I choose to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, would you do me a favor? If you just prayed that prayer with me, would you take a moment and pull out your Connect card? All of you, if you pull out your Connect card, there's a couple of things I'd like you to do. If you're joining us online, again, you can text Connect card to 484848, and here's what I want us to do. First, if you prayed with me that prayer, on the back, there's a place that says, "Today I committed my life to Christ." And we want to celebrate with you. Not only that, I want to send you some material that will help you to begin this journey of growing in Christ. This church exists to help people to know, to love, and to follow Jesus. That's what we're all about. And so if you prayed that prayer with me, welcome to the family. I want to help you to begin that journey of growth by sending you some material. Here's the second thing. For all of us in the room, do me a favor. On the front, there's a place that says, "How'd you hear about this service?" I would love to know how you heard about this, whether it was social media, maybe you saw a TV ad, maybe it was a postcard you received, or maybe somebody invited you. Help us understand, how did you get here? We would love to know about that. And then third, on the back, there's a place for prayer requests. Now listen, for the last 21 years, I've asked every Christmas for the honor of praying for you. And I want to pray this year for you specifically. So let me put it this way. If God could answer just one prayer for you in 2021, what would it be? Would you do me the honor of praying for you and with you? Just write that prayer down, and over the holidays, I'm going to look over every card and I want to pray for you specifically that God would do what only God can do, is to turn the impossible around and transform lives. So let me know how I can pray for you. And then finally, there's one more thing before I turn over the service to that portion where we're going to celebrate Christ as the light of the world, and it's this. Maybe you're ready to give a gift back to Jesus of taking the first step as a believer. And the very first step that Christ asks for believers is to follow him in baptism. And so at every single Christmas service, we offer folks an opportunity to take that first step. So if that's you and you're ready to take that step, you say, "How could I be ready to take that step? I'm not ready for that." Well, guess what? We're ready. We have a change of clothes, towels, and everything you could possibly need. So all you have to do is in the lobby, there's a big sign that says baptisms, and there'll be some folks right under that. If you're ready to take that step, we have a private room where you can take that step, and we'll help you to do that. We would love, love, love to help you to take that step. So right now, we're at that point of the service where we're going to celebrate together Jesus as the light of the world. I'm going to turn it over. Venue pastor will be coming up, but I want to, before I end tonight, say especially to you, I love you guys. God bless you, and have a great Christmas. Love you.
You know, this Jesus that we talked about tonight is the hope of the world, but he is the light of the world as well. He says this in John 8:12. He says, "I am the light of the world, and whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." You know, when you follow Jesus, you don't have to walk in darkness, meaning you never have to walk in darkness wondering how much God loves you. You never have to walk in darkness wondering, how do I get forgiveness of my sins? Or walk in darkness and wondering, where will I spend eternity? No, Jesus and his love for us promises to reveal all of that as we heard tonight in his word. He loves us and he cares about us. And you don't even have to walk through dark times alone because Jesus promises to be with us always. But you know, it doesn't stop there too, because just as Jesus is the light of the world, he calls us to be the light of the world around us. He says this in Matthew 5:14. He says, you that are following me, you are the light of the world. In other words, take what I have given you, peace and hope, and shine that bright to everyone around you. Shine that bright to your family. Shine that bright to those that you work with. Shine that bright to those in your neighborhood. Take what I've given you and show them me, the hope of the world, the light of the world. It's Jesus. So as we pull out our phones and we sing Silent Night together in just a minute, here's what I want you to remember. Two things as we do this. We do this first to remember who Jesus is, the light of the world. But we also do it to remember what we're called to do, to be the light to the world around us. So would you stand now, and if you're in our other venues or watching online, I encourage you to join us as well. And let's all turn the lights onto our phones as we remember Jesus as the light of the world.
Silent night,
Hey, if you prayed that prayer with Pastor Brian to accept Jesus into your heart, first of all, wow, that is amazing. We would love to celebrate with you and talk about what that means for your life. Let us know that you did that by typing yes in the chat or filling out a connect card. You also heard that Pastor Brian wanted to pray for you specifically going into 2021. What is the one thing that you need prayer for the most as we begin the new year? Fill out your connect card and let us know so that we can be praying for you. Listen, we don't take an offering at our Christmas services here, but if you feel led to give an end of the year offering or a one-time gift, feel free to do so at rbc.net/give. Thank you so much for joining us for Christmas this year. I promised that hope would be revealed, and Pastor Brian showed us that hope's name is Jesus. He truly is the light of the world. Listen, we love you, we are praying for you, and we hope to see you next week at Oak Ridge Online at our usual times. Merry Christmas.